Yes, we are right now.
Okay.
We'll still have this catalog, right. So we need right. to go back to it, okay. like you said.
Yeah. I really like you. This is for
I appreciate realtor, it.
But later on, I might not tell you that.
Okay, that's fine. But right now, we are. Okay. This is the pre-production okay. of the show piece, Knowledge and Wisdom. The day it's going to be with Brother Billy Jam, William Zimmerman. I don't know what he would rather me call him when I introduce him. Do you have any preference?
Okay, not at all.
He's affectionately known by a lot of my viewers, our viewers out there. You guys knew him as Billy Jam, part of the community for the last 50 years. 50 years as far as being a celebrity of Steubenville, if you will, at least for me, being a younger toddler up underneath his stardom. But we're doing this pre-production, just a little bit of what happens behind the scenes. You're seeing a little bit of my production. I like to let the guests know what we're going to talk about. One of the things we want to do, this is going to be a positive show. We'll have some other shows where we get into, actually, I consider all my shows positive. But at some point, when you talk about the Black experience in America, which is what peace, knowledge, and wisdom is about, it's the Black experience in America. It wasn't all pretty. It wasn't all positive.
I agree with that.
But if the goal of what we have here in this show is to get solutions to those problems, we're not here just to point out what the problems were or what they or whoever did to us. What can we do now to get better in the future is what some of the things we'll talk about. But because we're coming up on Black History Month, just got over Martin Luther King's birthday, we're going to keep something positive. And I'm going to have Brother Zimmerman basically go in on what was it like since Martin Luther King left in 1968? I believe he got assassinated. From then to now in Steubenville, give me the positives. And what was Steubenville like in the 60s and 70s? Then what was it like in the 80s and 90s? And then the present day, in the turn of the century. What are we missing that we used to have? What was bad then but is better now? What is bad now but used to be great then? So I want you to get some highlights of Steubenville, and we're going to walk through that. And at times, I'm going to write down other questions. I'll interrupt you. We may go off and talk about that one specific thing for a little while and then come back. Is that something that you want to do?
That's fine.
You willing to do?
I'm really doing.
Okay,
what
and then
you say, man?
And then at the last 10 minutes, if there's anything that's on your mind you'd like to talk about, we'll do that. We'll chop it up back and forth.
Okay.
So that's what we got here. We're going to set up, making sure everything is good with our angles and making sure our voice is good. We want to set up our theme music for that you guys already know in peace, knowledge, and wisdom. My theme music is Brother Isaac Hayes.
All right, I liked it.
I got a brother named Rock Newman who does a show that I really enjoy that I watch. He has a lot of inspiring people on there. And his theme music is We Are One by Maze.
And I like that too.
And so I just get fired up when I get ready to watch him. Because it's like...
Dun, I like dun, Joy and Pain by Maze.
Joy and Pain, yeah. A lot of things. Another thing we're going to talk about is music. We already said this. One of our other... Yeah. Not today probably, but one of our other
music
things we'll talk about music.
Is a good branch.
And I want to go into... I seen Frankie Beverly the last two times I've seen him. He's been amazing. But the time before that I seen him, I didn't think he was going to be singing anymore. They said his throat was losing his voice
but
and stuff.
Anyway, truthfully, but I've seen him over 40 times.
Oh, I've probably seen him at least 15.
There you go.
But what I'd love to see, I seen, I don't know if you've seen we're just getting the stuff ready. We'll be on live here shortly.
Okay. It's documented.
This idea came to me. You know, I get all these ideas.
Mm-hmm.
I went to go see Fantasia, Charlie Wilson and Johnny Gill concert up in Columbus. It was one of the best concerts I've ever been to.
I saw them a couple years ago, too.
Okay. In Columbus?
Cincinnati Jazz Festival.
Oh, yeah. Well, I didn't see Johnny Gill in there, but I know
Johnny Gill wasn't there.
The Jazz Festival you're talking about, though, yeah. I've been in one of those before. But anyway, Johnny Gill started. Then it was Fantasia, then Charlie. But Fantasia, she's number one on my list to go see in concert. She's just 150%.
I like her, too.
In what she does. Anyway... Johnny Gill did his set, did a good job, came out, did a good job. Then all of a sudden, he ended his show, and it was all dark. We was thinking they're going to set up for Fantasia. All of a sudden, spotlights came on, and there were some bongos on the thing, just the bongos, spotlight on the bongos. Then all of a sudden, you heard, dum, dum, kind of slow. And then Johnny Gill came out. People started going crazy, and he started going... And gradually he got faster.
He did amazing.
Joy! And then the band started joining. And pain. So remember that part that goes. And he did that.
And the crowd all joined in.
And everybody knew what he was doing. And he said, Hey, just like amazing. And he sang the song. And everybody sang it with him. Gave me a great idea. We need this right now. Maze should get Johnny Gill to take Frankie's place.
I agree with you.
He should join the group on tour with them.
Feature.
Every now and then sing a song with Frankie. Gradually sing one of the songs by himself.
He needs help. If that's what we're saying.
And not so much as he needs help else? That he could all of a sudden be gone any day and Maze may be done.
Featuring.
There's too much Johnny history. There's too much history we lose. ADC, when they lost their main guy way back, they replace him. But, and they keep that music going and they continue to. That's our culture.
I seen something else, though. Howard Hewitt featuring. Maze featuring Howard Hewitt would be a good one. I ain't just picking. You got to see it.
I wouldn't have a problem. I ain't got a problem with either one of them. I think Johnny Gill is one of the most underrated singers we've had. I love Luther Vandross. My favorite performer ever is Al Green. Because I just like his music.
Well,
I like his song. Oh, yeah, I got an old soul. Yeah. But anyway, my point is basically is we don't need to lose that culture by because Frankie Beverly's gone. All of a sudden, Maze fade out and do the old circuit thing.
No. I'm hoping
they need to continue to produce, but they need them songs need to be a part of the concert.
Frankie something else.
Yeah, I need to be going to those when I'm 70. Yeah. I need to be going to those same concerts with that same fire to, you know, good singing and the music sound just like the record. That's one thing I love about Maze. So go ahead, listen. What are you going to say
Frankie
about that?
The first tour when he first came out with Joy and Pain Live.
Not Live in New Orleans.
Oh, yeah. So.
Good deal.
Actually, I saw Frankie Beverly and Maze also the first time.
He
was the warm-up act for Ronnie Laws.
Is that right? Deborah and Ronnie?
I was with Kai. Deborah wasn't there.
Oh, okay.
I was with Kai Kai.
Now, was he jazz or was he rhythm and blues?
Ronnie Laws. Friends and Strangers is his hit. He didn't have.
But, I mean, was he considered jazz? That's what I thought. I thought so, but I didn't know for sure.
I'll tell you a quick story.
Go ahead.
Anyway, Frankie Beverly's playing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm out in the lobby. Because I never heard of him, but I didn't know he was this and that.
Right.
He was throwing down so hard, everybody went in and sat down.
Uh-huh.
So, real quick, when the concert was over, mm-hmm. Ronnie Laws comes out impromptu.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, ladies and gentlemen, Ronnie Laws, because he had a hit out called Saturday Evening and Friends and Strangers.
Okay.
It was number one in the country.
Okay.
And he says, hey, what can you do after that? And he said, wee. He goes into Friends of Strangers. The place goes crazy. Who's sitting around on the stage with Frankie Beverly's band and all that? It was just like a real jazz session.
Is that right?
And I got to spend time with Kai Kai and Nardi Horsen was there.
Yeah, okay.
And they'll tell you, I looked over at them. Maybe Moosey, those guys are 3 years older than me. Mm-hmm. Nardi's 6 years older than me or seven.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, and it was just a unique experience.
Good deal. Good
Frankie Beverly was never. Well,
Frankie Beverly. Yeah. And you could probably give me some of your other greatest good times you've had at a Frankie Donzer concert. Frankie Beverly concert. Yes. Maze and how good that was and the experience of how people get them to the songs and stuff. Public Enemy, Frankie Beverly,
I saw Public Enemy with my son.
And Fantasia are the three best concerts I've ever been to as far as the electricity.
Right.
Best performances would be Fantasia, Maze, and probably Patti LaBelle.
I agree with
that. I've seen her in live. Luther Vandross is always up there, but he's just what he is. He's just a solid balladeer, great singer, performers, perfectionist, and things like that. Okay,
I gotta send you Jaheim then.
You send it to me.
Oh, okay.
I got it. That's what I said. You got it. It's ridiculous. Stand over there. Okay. We're gonna get started here.
All right.
When I say your name, you'll walk towards me. I'll shake your hand. We'll sit down and we'll get started. All right. This ain't the song right now, but you know this song, don't you? This is?
That's Isaac Hayes, right?
Yeah, it is. My man. I love people to know music. But this is the one we're going to use.
I like that one.
Oh, yeah, I do too.
But on the shed, there's one that goes beat. That's what
I'm using. Come on. Now all of a sudden. All of a sudden it's clocking. All right, here we go. Hello, we're here again with Peace, Knowledge, Wisdom. Hello, my name is Michael McIntyre, and I thank you for joining us in our continued discussion on the Black experience in America. As always, we welcome your comments and questions, on our topics and opinions. Also, if you have not done so, please watch our first show where we break down the purpose, goal, and construction of this show. It will help you understand the tone and tenor of our discussions. Okay, we're here now, and we're going to have another show. I want to thank everybody for joining me. Be sure to hit the like button, the subscribe button, also the dislike button if you dislike what we got to say here. But also hit that bell so you're notified of any time we put these shows on. Got a great show planned for you today, what we call positive show. I think everything we do is positive, but we want to talk about some of the good times, being here in the Black History Month coming up, Martin Luther King Day, being in January now. We're going to concentrate a little bit on Black history. Black history, but not just nationally in our national experience, but our local experience here in Steubenville. So with no further ado, my next guest here, some of you know him real well. I've known him all my life, not personally, but know of him. Because in some sense in Steubenville, he was somewhat of a celebrity as I grew up. And it's none other than William Billy Jam Zimmerman. Billy, good to see you, brother.
You too, man.
Thank you for joining us.
And respect, man.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I don't know about the celebrity thing, though.
Well, I'm going to... it's almost like when somebody says, are you someone that is a loving person? It's not. It's a little bit easy for you to say you're a loving person, but need to talk to people you affect. Because you don't describe yourself a loving person. Somebody else should feel your love.
Okay.
That's the only way it can be. Now, you can tell who you think is a loving person, because that means you've felt that. And so your celebrity on me,
okay,
and on many of the people, we'll have a couple. We'll talk about those stories in a minute.
Here. Okay, all
right. But
let's get to it.
We're gonna get to it now. So the first thing we're gonna do, being that it's Black History Month, Martin Luther King Day. A lot of people talk about King. One of the things you hear that's always been a cry that most people will say when it comes to racial issues and the state of the Black community nowadays. They always talk about, well, we haven't got where we want to be, but we've come a long way. I could challenge that. I could say we're basically right where we were the day that Martin Luther King died.
I would agree with some of that.
And that would be an analogy type situation where I could say the things he was fighting for then are the same things we're fighting for now. And so if you get a drink of water and you here know it's contaminated because it got 50 drops of cyanide in it, somebody brings it to you later and say, go ahead and take it because there's only 40 drops. Is it still, would you drink it?
No.
Is it been cleaned up?
No, it ain't.
Is it better than it was before?
I would agree and say no.
Exactly, because a drink of it would be destructive. And the systems that Martin Luther King fought against are still destructive as it relates to the Black community. But then again, there are some things that we smiled, sometimes along these ways that we smiled, some of these times that we succeeded, some victories that we've had. And I want to kind of find out, what was Steubenville like from the day Martin Luther King got assassinated, which you are a child of the 60s, I believe you were born in the 60s, or was growing up in the 60s in Steubenville, and in the 70s. I would like you to put them in three eras, the 60s and 70s.
Okay.
Whether it's what your mom told you and your grandma told you, or whether what you experienced. Then go to the 80s and 90s, which I would assume you'd call your heyday. That'd be when you was at your prime and your peak powers, as they would say.
Okay.
And then to the turn of the century, the 2000s, the last 20 years.
Okay.
Put those in three different things and tell us about Steubenville as seen through your eyes.
Well, let me just back up. I was born in the 50s.
Okay.
And I was born in 1958.
Look at this, born in the 50s.
Yeah. So, my life was jumped. In 1958, I was born, mm-hmm. and in 1961, I considered myself the first project boy in the valley. I moved into the North End Projects in 1961.
Nice.
That's when everybody's family moved in, and we were happy.
Out the North End?
North End.
Same property that they're on now?
Same property. And we moved from Sherman Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
to the projects, and there to the famous Linden Avenue.
Okay.
We call it, there's a lot of heart there.
Yeah,
but anyway, jumping back to trying to get your question, because it's really vague, but in 1968, then you'll say I'm 10 years old.
Okay.
And I'm first time seeing the world. And going, back then you don't have the media and things like that that's showing you our culture or anything. Mm-hmm. So when you watch News 9, that's what you think the whole world sees. Mm-hmm. I don't national news and local news.
Right.
So you guys look at me as a kid. But anyway, I felt that I was being exposed to things and really, really spoiled. My dad put the time in. And my mom, my parents, because at the age, I'll tell this story real quick. When I was 9 and 10, I went to a basketball camp in Cincinnati, Ohio. And when I get there, there's like 30 or 40 kids. It's not the glamour like now, right? And there's this big black guy running the camp. And after the first evening, my dad leaves. I cried like a little baby. First time I was on my own. And the guy was mean. There's only one other black kid. But long story short, he was Oscar Robinson. So my dad had treated me to something special. And I gave him a hard time. I was the bad kid at the camp because I thought I could outplay everybody that was there. But in long story short, I could dribble when nobody else could. So it's not like I was super good. So, and he worked with me. And anyway, I was exposed to that and didn't learn until later on who Oscar Robinson was. So now back home in the 60s, I'm going through the era of seeing families, which is different. The whole town was centered around churches. Families had structure. The big mama syndrome, you could call that, where there was a grandma in everybody's household.
Yes.
And the aunts and the neighbors were all, you really had a neighborhood. And it was like CRC was our foundation. In our churches. So we had a community place to go to. And I guess there was things for adults too. We weren't allowed down on where there were bars and things like that. You knew you couldn't cross the line. So we had structure from the north end to the south end. And the churches, we had drill teams. There was activities. The preachers were really leaders in the community. And Second Baptist seemed to have to step up, whoever that minister was. And
so then you would have called... Second Baptist, the big church, or the
I would call it
the main big church of Steubenville at that time.
The big church.
Okay.
Yeah. And it gravitated to, it seemed like things were going in a real positive way in the black community, if you ask me, because we were all together.
Okay.
Then I think prosperity comes in. The 70s, we all start going to college. You see kids doing things. Kids are being recruited. I think Robert Washington went to Notre Dame in 1970.
Okay.
So you see this, and Archie Griffin and Cornelius Green, Ohio State got these guys, and they're coming to our town. And believe it or not, at this time, we might get back to a positive statement on Mr. Perry Jeter. He was the janitor at Grant School when Archie Griffin came, and I'd say that would be 1972.
Let's park there for a second.
Okay.
1961, as a young man, 3 years old, you moved into the North End Projects. That was when you were one of the first families in the new
first
North End Projects. So that right there, some of the viewers may not know, those who are local here, that's how old those North End Projects are.
Right.
I never knew that. Now, I do remember as a kid, and I was born in 66, I do remember when the South End Projects started to open, because they were newer, and I think that must have been sometime in this, I'd say, between 68 and 72. I would assume, because I think my great-grandmother, she was one of the first ones down there.
Right.
Mother Hunt, she lived down there. And so I remember as a kid, that being a new area. I remember it was dug up, and as they put the things together, it just looked so great down there, you know. And whether somebody said projects to me then or not, was no different than if somebody said that's a building. They didn't have no negative connotation. It was just considered the project. So
we're glad to be there.
So they look beautiful. And they still are beautiful. Right. You know, you get people to come from the city and see our projects and say, they ain't no projects. Projects are about 15 stories high with 50,000 people in one project. Right. But in any event, we know that as far as the black experience in America, it was the projects. And it was what, quote unquote, the ghetto for various reasons that we may get into. But what I want to look at this, and I'd say you were 15 in 1973.
Right.
And you had experienced Oscar Robertson.
And didn't know it.
Didn't know it. You experienced, you had a knowledge of Archie Griffin. Those two are just icons in Ohio lore. Griffin, first two-time and only two-time Heisman Trophy winner at Ohio State. Right. You have Oscar Robertson, who won a state, who won a national championship with Cincinnati, I believe. Cincinnati, right. I think he went to Cincinnati. I think they won the state, a national championship when he was there.
Yeah, I believe. I think he went high up in there, and they were. He was the player of the year.
Or they lost to Ohio State.
He was Olympic champion.
Went to an Olympic champ, and then he won an NBA championship with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar in Milwaukee. Or with the Bucks. I don't know if they were the
Milwaukee Bucks. Was,
yeah, okay. So those are two icons that you came in contact with. Lowell William Zimmerman of Steubenville, Ohio, has contact in his youth with that. Another thing you said, you mentioned structure. Now, when you say that, do you just say that as I'm telling the story of that's how it was? Or are you contradicting? Did that structure, are we going to, do you think we still have that same structure now?
No.
And do you
I don't think we have communities like we used to have.
That's fine. You can articulate it more as you get there. But I want to, for the audience, I want to try to just, because sometimes when you reflect back, if you go through things, you might be able to hit points of some answers to what we're experiencing now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe different than what you may have thought. You talked about the CRC, recreation. It was affectionately known as the pool.
The pool.
Because we had a pool up there. This is in the 60s.
All black ran.
And the 70s, all black ran. Yeah. A pool. A whole recreation facility.
Right.
All black ran. We ever had that since that place left?
No, nothing like that. Nothing. And
could we have used it?
Oh, it was it was everything.
So again,
it was everything.
I just want to
say, Miss Maddie. Yeah,
people Burns. Would think I was crazy.
We thought she owned the building.
Yeah, you agreed, and you said when I said there could be an argument that we are no better off from the point when Martin Luther King died in 1968.
I think we're
than we are now. That would be a testament to that. In 1968, we had the CRC. It was black owned, or at least black ran, you said. I'm sorry.
It was. No, it's a city building.
Well, black ran, so it wasn't black owned.
Cecil Fletcher.
Black ran.
And Miss Maddie.
The black community was there. Let me ask you this question. I've heard all the stories about this, and I was there a couple years before it had closed down. Was there ever any white kids there?
Very few. And they but I saw them just come to play basketball. And that's
so,
later.
So you did have some white people, some white kids that came and played there.
I saw one or two play
basketball. Was there any leagues there?
Yes.
Did any white teams come in and play in the league at all?
I've never seen
that. You've never seen that. But every now and then you see a white kid in and out of there, probably lived in the community somewhere.
No.
They would walk all the way there just to come, maybe a friend of yours.
No, I'll say Gary Rapella.
He would come and play.
Gary Rapella, I saw later.
And why do you think he was there? Key word I'm looking for.
Because he was good?
There you go. Competition.
Yeah.
He was trying to, he wanted to, I believe, and this is, I don't know nothing about this, you can tell me. Mm-hmm. I think he wanted to know how good he was. Or he already knew how good he was and he wanted to show it off because I'm good there.
Yeah, I think
then
so.
Then I'm good.
But the camaraderie was different.
Okay.
And when he came, they could say, you know, I'm going to say there was a few more because I wasn't there every day, but I was there every other day, you might as well say.
Yeah, I understand.
And
he was always there. He was there a lot.
He was there a lot during
Who was
that
he with?
Time.
You remember?
He was with the big red basketball players.
Okay. Who did he play with at that time? Do you remember?
I forget that. I forget exactly, but Les Washington.
Okay.
I remember
I've heard that name.
To me, he's the greatest Jeter on that all time.
Okay.
That's my favorite.
Okay.
You know, you talk about Jeters all the time, so I'm positive. Right. You got Ryan Terry.
Yeah.
Played
you mean Ryan Jeter?
Ryan Terry
is
a Jeter.
Oh, okay.
His mom is a Jeter.
Oh, I didn't. Okay, good deal.
Yeah.
Good deal.
Okay. And
I know Jason.
Les is his nephew.
Okay.
I mean, Les
is
Ryan
uncle.
Is his uncle.
Okay.
And, yeah, his sister.
Oh, his
sister is
Ryan's mom.
Okay,
yeah, then I do know.
Because
okay.
the Terry family might be famous, but the Jeter family, I mean, Bob Jeter.
Okay.
There's like 10 Jeters in the pros.
Yep, okay.
And then my favorite of all time, Perry Jeter.
Right. Now, was he related to them Jeters also?
Yes.
Is that right? Yes. Okay. So, okay, I'll let you get back on that, but I just wanted to park there for a couple reasons. One is... Gary Rapella, you mentioned his name being in the in there. I always like to see it when you see, which I know we talked about this before, we started the Steubenville Tigers.
Right.
One of the things we never did was say it was an all-black group, obviously.
You did.
And we had a lot of white kids that played for us, a lot of white parents that brought their kids to us. And we was always amazed of the few that did. Right. But we were empowered by those that did, because almost all of them that came stayed.
Right.
Meaning they either felt welcomed or they felt it was a good program, mm-hmm. and they wanted their kids to be a part of it. And if right. you want your kids to be a part of something, you're giving it the okay. Right. So that was a thing. So it was always good to see that that is a little different, where he probably came on his own. You know, he was out right. playing basketball and he came on his own, like his parents sent him there. It's just exactly. he came on his own. But it's always good to know that, you know, it's not always friendly for us to go somewhere.
No, it's not.
But we always welcome. There's very, I've never known of a place where you couldn't come in, even if you're white, Chinese, Puerto Rican, or whatever, and to a black establishment, you know.
Exactly.
Or a black area, you know. So, okay, so we got a little bit of that. We're in 1973 now.
Okay.
So I kind of stopped you. You mentioned 1973.
1973 is...
You talked about Perry Jeter was the...
Mr. the was greatest.
A, was he a was janitor.
Janitor.
When Archie Griffin
came down. And we were actually in the locker room.
Mr. Jeter, a janitor.
And he stopped us from...
When he was a janitor, I'm sorry to keep interrupting you, but I think a lot of this is just interesting to me.
Because his life is a story here.
Oh, for sure. One of the, you know, but where had he been? You didn't probably notice as a kid, but maybe you did. Where had he been before he was a janitor down at Grant School?
I saw him before that. Mm-hmm. I was the bat boy at the North End ball field.
Okay.
To show you how good he was. And this is from 9, 10, 11. I'm a bat boy out there with all the greats just playing softball.
Yeah, I understand.
He showed up one day, and he didn't play all the time.
Right.
Great legend, Cy Brown and all mm-hmm. that. He stole the whole show on a Sunday. He pitched, he batted, he played shortstop.
Did you know who
back.
He was at
no,
that time?
And I'm looking at him.
But did everybody else knew who he was, right?
Yeah. At the
nobody ever they, told you?
Right, but he wasn't a regular
What about
player.
After that? Did somebody so, tell you?
No, because I'm running around playing like a kid, just playing
so you
basketball,
still didn't know who he was.
Swinging on swings.
So there was no rumors about where he had been?
I don't know nothing about him.
Okay, go ahead.
I just remember him stealing the show and playing baseball.
You knew he was one of the best athletes you
and
ever
dominated,
seen.
Right. And okay. Cy Brown and all them guys are out
okay.
here. I'm saying his name twice. The legends.
Okay.
And he wasn't a fixture in that league.
Right.
But that day... Mm-hmm. He dominated the game
okay.
and put on a show. You so, know, you talk like a... He was like Bingo Long and All-Stars.
And a traveling All-Stars.
Yeah.
So when once you've seen that,
so
then you've seen him down as a janitor.
I go to Grant School.
Did you know he's the same guy?
I know he's the same guy.
I respect him
as Mr. Jeter now.
Yes. Okay.
He's the janitor.
Yes.
And he's running the whole locker room, school, coaching. He's keeping
so
us
So he's also
order.
Coaching too?
No. He's coaching us just being nice.
Being
he's
nice.
Not, he's a janitor. That's
and,
his
and to
title.
The black kids, he's, which is mostly right. mostly that's what it was
right.
down at Grant.
Right.
He was like an authoritarian.
Yeah, to give you insight, Archie Griffin is short and little.
Yeah.
We're in the locker room with the team with our teammates, and I'm telling you can't play. You're the other guys, we're
saying that to who? Archie?
We're snubbing Archie Griffin.
So you're the same age as Archie?
No. I'm in eighth grade, seventh
and
grade,
he is,
and he's at Ohio State.
So he's older than you.
No, yeah, he should be 19 or 20.
Okay,
for Ohio
good
State.
Deal. I just want
to. So he came down to our banquet.
Good deal.
He was the
good
speaker.
Deal. Good deal. Okay.
So now we got him in the locker room.
Okay.
We gonna jump on him. We telling him you ain't nothing, this and that. Mr. Jeter comes in and stops us. The coach, believe it or not, is Mr. Renardo.
Okay, I know the name.
Rich Lucas.
Okay.
Mr. Jeter shuts us down.
Good deal.
And he runs, he takes care of the gym,
I understand.
Lines us up.
I understand.
So he's our big brother, authority,
yes.
everything.
Okay.
He keeps order in the school. So now I leave Grant.
Okay, you go to high school.
I go to high school. He's taking classes. By the time I graduate from high school, he took classes at the College of Steubenville.
That's fine.
And graduate,
you still don't
gets
know
his
who
bachelor's.
He is.
I know him, but...
No, no, what I mean is who he is.
I don't know he played for the Bears and
you
all that.
You still don't know
I don't
this.
Know that part.
That's fine.
So,
go ahead.
So then...
So what I was trying to connect, and you'll connect me. I'm sorry okay. for interrupting you. I just want to make sure we have some continuity.
Okay. Yeah, I don't thoughts. Know he played for Chicago Bears.
Is that... why? That's why I said he's a janitor.
Janitor.
He had played for who?
Chicago Bears. Scored Lewis Lips, whatever Lewis Lips did at
Let me
the
ask
Steelers.
You this.
He scored a punt.
Just a frame of reference. Ball. Frame of reference.
Yeah, he did it all.
Could you imagine Ryan Terry? He wasn't nearly as good as Mr. Jeter as far as his success in the pros, I don't think.
Ryan was successful business-wise.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm saying as far
he
as the actual on the field.
But, yeah, Mr. Jeter played both ways.
Yeah.
It's different.
And
we talking.
Yeah. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Because my point is, could you imagine if Ryan had to be the janitor?
No, I can't imagine that.
At Big Red? After he came, he would leave.
I can't imagine none of us doing that. Not just Ryan. I wouldn't put it on Ryan.
Well, my point is,
I can't imagine none of us.
And I'm not even saying back. You say us.
If I was a pro and came back,
any pro,
I can't see it.
Could you see Zach Kolaris coming now being the janitor down there? And you know why he wouldn't be the janitor? Not because he wouldn't want to be. It would be if he just need a job and wants to work, and that's all that's available. Maybe he would. But do you think the powers that be would let him be the janitor?
No. I tell you.
So I'm just wondering why.
I'll say something else for Mr. G.
So for the
when he became.